next speaker is Dr. Csikvári from Eötvös Loránd University, and he's going to talk about counting degree constraint subgraphs and orientation.
Thank you very much, and let me thank the organizers for inviting me. So this is a joint work with Márton Borbényi. He's a bachelor student, actually a sophomore student. So what I will speak about is mostly not new. It will be mostly an advertisement for an already existing method. And in some sense, the title could have been applications of invariance theory to graph theory. So let me first describe some of these applications. These will be cute, simple statements, and as we will see, all of them can be proved within a few lines with the already known method. Okay. So the first theorem which I would like to show is the theorem of Lex Schreiber. Actually, I cannot really pronounce his name because in the Dutch there is a Schreiber, yes. So please accept my apology. So let G be a Dirac graph on n vertices, and D is even. And we would like to count the number of Eulerian orientations, so the number of orientations where the in degree and out degree is D half. And then the theorem states that the number of Eulerian orientation is at least two times this constant, where this to the n, the constant is d choose d half divided by 2 to the d half. So an example, if d is 4, then 4 choose 2 is 6 divided by 2 to the 2 is 4. So this is 3 over 2. So it says that 4 regular graph G has at least 2 times 3 over 2 to the n Eulerian orientations. Actually, in the original theorem, there was no 2 here, but I put it because we will get it for free, so I just put there. Yes, actually, this is in some sense quite tight. If you consider a random D-regular graph, then you get constant times square root n times this exponential. So it's tied up to a constant times square root n. So later I will show a simple proof of this fact. Let me show a very similar result. So let's consider a 2k regular graph G, and again we count the number of Eulerian orientations, and also we count the k-regular subgraphs, so we consider the edge subsets where the degree of each vertex is exactly k. And the claim is that we have always at least as many Eulerian orientation as k-regular subgraphs. Actually, it's true in more general, so if all degrees are even, then you can consider these half graphs where the degree is exactly the half of the original graph, and the number of Eulerian orientation is always at least as large as the number of these half subgraphs. Is it clear? So regularity is not really important. I will show the proof for four regular graphs because then you can imagine the whole proof. A third application, suppose that we have a connected three regular graph on n vertices, and this time we just choose an orientation uniformly at random, and let n plus be the number of sources, and let n minus the number of sinks, and we would like to know the probability that n plus minus n minus is exactly k. And it turns out that it does not depend on the graph G as long as it is a connected three regular graph. It is always n choose n half minus 2k divided by 2 to the n minus 1. I found it quite surprising when we first conjectured it. And then we will see that it will follow very easily.
There's no condition on the orientation?
No, just uniformly at random, you choose one of the 2 to the number of edges orientation. So at every edge, you choose randomly one of the orientation. The probability one half one half. So if k is zero, then this is n choose n half divided by 2 to the n minus 1. So this is the probability that the number of sources is equal to the number of things. Actually, a much more general statement is true. So something miracle happens for three regular graphs, but actually one can prove something stronger theorem. And this time I can tell you that there is an elementary proof for it. I mean, I gave it to freshman students and they come up with some nice proofs. Anyway. This is not always true. I mean, for instance, I don't know an elementary proof of this fact, but there should be one. So, I mean, I just don't know. But you can give it as an exercise for university students and then some will come up.
You're in freshman.
Okay. A last application, it's a bit more involved. So first of all, I need this matching polynomial or monomer dimer partition function. So we have a graph G, and let MKG denote the number of matchings of size K. The number of matchings of size K. And we choose some lambda, and we consider this sum of MKG lambda to the K. So this is, in mathematics, it's called matching generating function. In statistical physics, it's the partition function of the monomer dimer model. Anyway, if I say something which is not clear, I know that here there are computer scientists, mathematicians, and statistical physicists, with all of them having their own terminology. So if I say some word which is not clear, just feel free to interrupt me and ask. Okay, and we are doing the following game. So given a three regular graph G, we substitute each vertex with a triangle. So we do this transformation. So this is a delta y transformation at each vertex, actually y delta. And then we would like to minimize this quantity, the logarithm of this matching polynomial of this triangle truncated graph, divided by the number of vertices. And the claim is that it doesn't have a minimizing graph. It turns out that if you want to approximately minimize it, then you have to start from a large curves graph, so a graph with that small, with that short cycles, and do this transformation, and this will approximately minimize the graph. Actually, in some sense, the claim is that the infinitum is achieved by the infinite three regular tree, but then I have to explain that this sentence makes sense. So, and here I skip some words like Benjamin-Schramm convergence and things like that, but this makes sense actually.
But what is lambda then? What value?
Lambda is any positive number. So you choose your favorite lambda, say 1, and then this is for large Gauss graphs. Is there any question about it?
What about individual coefficients about their minimization?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. Yeah, that's a good question. Actually, this is not really the most natural question one can ask. Honestly, one would like to ask it for the original three regular graphs. But for the original graphs, the answer is quite complicated, actually. And mostly conjectured answer we have. So, yes. So, in the next few slides, I will speak about something called gauge transformation, but actually, a few people will know it in a different name. A few people might know it under holographic reduction, some other people reparameterization. So let me start again with a theorem of Lex Schreiber. So let G be a bipartite D-regular graph on 2n vertices. And let's consider the number of perfect matchings. Perfect matchings are dimer configurations, so those are the same. And then it claims that the number of perfect matchings is at least this constant to the n, so d minus 1 to the d minus 1 divided by d to the d minus 2. And I use this theorem as a motivation for the next theorem of Misha, Cserko, and Csernyák. So let G be again a D-regular graph G, D-regular graph on 2n vertices, and then there is a formula for the number of perfect matchings, and this is quite surprising for the first side. So again we have this constant here, and then for each subset of the edges we have some term. Now let's see what happens if we choose just the empty subgraph. Then this is the degree of the vertex V in this subgraph. So if we choose the empty subgraph, this is zero, so we have a one here and one here. So this seems to be some sort of main term here. And if, say, we choose a subgraph where there is a degree one vertex, then this is one minus one is zero, so this is zero, so this just cancels. And if, say, we have a cycle, then we have 2 here, 1 minus 2, this is minus 1 to the number of edges in this cycle, with some 1 over d minus 1 to the number of edges in the cycle. So somehow it gives a main term with additional terms. So this identity is a special case of a much more general family of identities. Which can be obtained by this gauge transformation technique. Now I will not speak about this gauge transformation or holographic reduction because Misha will give a talk on Thursday and he will speak about this. So this is a very useful thing. So there is something called normal factor graph, which actually also have several names in different literature. And it generalizes counting perfect matchings and homomorphisms, in particular colorings and independent sets. And then one can use this gauge transformation technique to obtain various identities for this partition function of this normal factor graph without changing this value. So see Misha talk on Thursday and there will be more details about it. But still, I would like to apply this technique without really explaining
it. By the way, yes? Those formulas, do they allow to get lower bounds?
This one?
No, or more general, yes. Could you get some kind of useful lower bounds from them?
Actually, it might be possible, but not for perfect matchings. Perfect match because there are D-regular graphs without any perfect matching.
Let's say for bipartite.
So unfortunately, I don't see any proof from this identity to this final. Actually, this was my original motivation, and as you will see, I have some progress, but still not.
And by the way, the bound is actually slightly better.
Yes.
But anyways. Yes.
Yes. So, in some problem, we can actually analyze this other terms and can get some improvement. I will show it for orientations. Okay, so I will introduce this subgraph counting polynomial, which is almost exactly the graph counting polynomial introduced by David Ruel. So let's consider a graph G, and for each degree I introduce some variable. So this will be belong to degree Z, zero, and this will be belong to degree D. So I choose all subset of the edges, and then I multiply x with the corresponding degree. So let's see an example. So here this is for K4, these are the terms. So when I choose the empty subgraph, then all degrees are zero, so x0 to the fourth. if I choose one edge as a subgraph, we can choose it in six ways, and then 2 degrees will be 1 and 2 degrees will be 0 in this subgraph. Is it clear?
Is there a way to write it like in terms of weights on edges, where each weight on the edge is a product of two?
Only in special cases, so this
is different.
So very slightly different, right? Honestly.
So
is it clear? So, okay. Okay, so yes. So I introduced this function, and this in particular computes a lot of things we have seen so far. So for instance, if I put a lot of zeros and one here at degree one, so then we only consider subgraphs where each degree is one, so it counts as perfect matchings. If we put one at degree zero and square root lambda at degree one, then this is mg lambda. We need square root lambda because we have two ends of the edge, and so square root lambda, it will be a lambda. And it turns out that if we want to compute the matching polynomial of this graph, then we have to plug in these quantities, 1 plus 3 lambda, 1 plus lambda, square root lambda, lambda, and lambda to the 3 half. Actually, it's quite easy to see why. So first you decide whether you include such an edge or not. So for instance, you may include this one, but not this one, and maybe not this one. And then from this triangle, you know that you can either include or not this edge, but nothing else. And so this will give, so if this is one, then you can either include it, and then this would be a lambda, or not include it, this is 1, so this is 1 plus lambda, and the square root lambda comes from this place, so here we have a square root lambda here, and a square root lambda here, so we get the lambda from here. So simply, one can evaluate this polynomial to get this truncated graph matching polynomial. And later I will show some speciality of these numbers and prove a theorem. So the first thing which comes out from this gauge transformation technique, that actually this polynomial has some symmetry. So there are matrices such that you can get FGX at equal to FG at RTX. So RT is some sort of rotation. I didn't write out here the example for R for T in general because the matrix is too large, but I gave here R pi 4, which you might recognize. So this is called Kravchuk matrix, and if you form polynomials from these rows, then those will be the Kravchuk polynomials. So they come up in coding theory. So in particular, if we consider the evaluation as 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, this means that we have to multiply this vector with this matrix, which just gives this third column, which gives 1 over 4, 6 is 3 over 2, 0, minus 1 half, and 3 over 2. So this will give this formula. So what is it? This counts the number of two factors in the graph because we have only one at degree two. So this counts the number of two factors, and then it gives there is another formula using all subgraphs where each degree is even because there is zero at degree one and degree three. Okay, so this is a direct application of this gauge transformation technique, which Misha will speak about on Thursday. Another way to attack these polynomials is to consider a differential form. So we consider this differentiation, and then it turns out that every graph G here for D regular graph G, the derivative of this polynomial is zero for this differentiation. Now, actually, this is not very surprising. So there, in invariant theory, we know that there are two sides of a coin. The other side was exactly this rotation, and the other one is this differentiation form. So we can always find such a thing, or at least in many cases.
But Peter, so yes, I mean, can you say more about this rotation? So there is always a semi group consisting of the identity matrix, but that's not what you mean, right?
So somehow this comes from a tensor product of small 2x2 rotation. So the large matrix is full of cosine t, sine t, and things like that.
So it's some kind of Clifford group, it's from there?
I don't know, but maybe yes. But we can compute it explicitly. I just didn't want to write that because first I wanted to put RT in general, and it turned out that I cannot put it into the slide. Even the 5x5 is too large.
So generally, do you always get this crotch of polynomials, or do you get other orthogonal polynomials in those matrices?
So I can tell actually the first row. So this is cosine t to the fourth. This is 4 times cosine cubed t sine t. This is 6 times cosine squared t sine squared t, and so on. But the other ones are a bit more complicated.
That's for this particular case, right? In general, so what do you get in general, do you know?
In what the general?
This is, for example, for 4 regular graphs, right? So.
Yes, so in general, for every d, we get at pi over 4 these Kravchuk matrices, and then in general we get some cosine t, sine t, and things like that. And yes, in some sense, there will be a generalization of these Kravchuk polynomials, so quite similar. Yes, I mentioned this differentiation, and this is quite useful actually. So you can consider the ring of those polynomials which vanish after applying this differentiation. And it turns out that this is a ring. It means that you can add and multiply polynomials and it won't lead that. And we will see soon that it is a finitely generated ring. And it turns out that there are some classical polynomials in these rings. For instance, if you consider this polynomial and you take the discriminant of this polynomial, then it will be in this ring. So you can apply this differentiation and it will vanish. This is very useful because sometimes when you compute, some polynomials just arise from the computation, and you can check whether this is an important polynomial or not. If you apply the differentiation and it is not zero, then it is not important. It was just a byproduct of the computation. But if it is zero, then you can expect that it has some meaning. Okay, so let's see how to get the generators of this ring. So first we look for linear polynomials such that the derivative, such that these are eigenvectors. So the derivative is some lambda times the same polynomial. And it turns out that the eigenvalues are d minus 2k times square root minus 1. So those are quite nice. So I gave the example here for d equal to 3. So these are the eigenvectors or eigenpolynomials of this differentiation. And if you apply Leibniz rule, so we have f times g is f. And so if it is lambda times f, some lambda f, and this is lambda g times g, then you can see that you will get a sum of lambdas and the product of these polynomials. Now, this means that if you can get a polynomial which vanishes, then you can write up as a sum of such polynomials in such a way that their sum lambdas are zero.
And this gives you the tensor structure. It's like tensor matrices times identities.
Yes. 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 And now we can ask, okay, we have these polynomials, subgraph counting polynomials, what happens if we write up in this basis? And it turns out that we need orientation this time. So given an orientation, then an oriented degree is just the r degree minus the n degree. So it's a number between d and minus d and having the same parity as d. And then the theorem is simply that if you want to write out f g, then you just consider all orientations, product of this eigen polynomials at the oriented degree, and divide 1 over 2 to the number of edges. Is it okay? So this way we get a connection between subgraph counting and orientation counting.
Sorry, it's okay, but give us maybe 30 seconds more.
Okay.
So why is it ki times k there? The del q of k is...
So we had this derivation of q, where some k was d minus 2ki times the qk. And then we can write fg in terms of this orientation. So for instance, if we orient this way, then we have a q minus 3 here because the n degree is 3. Here we have 1, and so this will be q1. This will be q1. So this will give a q1 cube, q minus 3. So what is it good for? So we can first of all introduce this orientation polynomial now. So we sum up for all orientations and then we just put y oriented degree. So for instance, if we have a four regular graph G and we have 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, this means that the oriented degree is 0 at every vertex. So this means that we have an Eulerian orientation. And what we have seen now, that there is a matrix Q that if you multiply x, the vector x with this matrix Q, then FGX is exactly AGQX. And it turns out that if you do this computation, if you want to compute the number of Eulerian orientations, then you have to evaluate the subgraph counting polynomial at 3 over 2, 1 over 2, 3 over 2. And immediate consequence that if you just keep the empty subgraph where each degree is 0, then we have 3 over 2 to the n, or the complete graph, so the full graph, then we have 3 over 2 to the n also from the last graph, so we get this. And all other terms are non-negative, so 2 times 3 over 2 to the n. And of course you can get some improvement on it by keeping more terms, say short cycles. So you can get a better subexponential term. That was your question at some point. And other applications, if we want to compare two factors with Eulerian orientation. So now we see that Eulerian orientation is equal to this one. And previously we have seen that the two factors, number of two factors is equal to this one. Now, in term by term, we see that this is bigger than this one. We only have to decide when it happens that this minus 1 to the something cancels, and it turns out that it cancels for bipartite graphs. Actually, for bipartite graphs, it's quite easy to see that the number of Eulerian orientation is the same as the k-regular subgraphs in a 2k-regular, because you just keep the edges going in one direction.
So and you get the bound, and you get the bound, say, in the bipartite case. So you get the bound on k-regular subgraphs of 2-regular graph.
Yes.
And it's the same as Schreier bound without extra with improvement or not.
So it turns out that this will be the main term, and it will be the same.
Because
yes.
I also had
yes.
improvement of the bound. I'm just curious: is it the same improvement as
is in my paper?
I guess this will be the same. Yes.
I see the same.
I have a question.
Yes.
Does this also imply? At the core, that there's some kind of stability, but with respect to a different set other than the upper half plane.
So I don't know whether there is a stability here or not at all. So actually, David Wagner has some results about it, that it doesn't vanish in some region, but I don't remember the exact result. What about this connected 3-regular graph? So it turns out that if you want to write up this probability generating function, then you just have to evaluate the orientation polynomial at 1 over tt. And the big magic is that when you write it as a polynomial of subgraph counting, then the degree 1 and degree 2 elements will be 0. And it turns out that if G is connected and we have FG A 0, 0, B, then this is equal to A to the n plus B to the n. You cannot keep any other subgraph of the original graph than the empty and the original graph, because it would contain a degree 1 or a degree 2 vertex, and this would give a 0. So this would give A to the n, B to the n, and then you just have to plug in these tools and you get this identity. Now actually there is a fun point here. So it's somewhat miserable to find the gauge transformations always, and there is a better way to prove this identity here, just by analyzing the generators of the ring. If it's true, so suppose that we have the generators of the ring, and suppose that for each generators they are the same as two different points, then of course this implies that for all polynomial in the ring, this will be they will be the same. Now this is quite nice, because then you just have to check a finite number of polynomials in the ring. So in case of 3-regular graphs, you have to actually check the following 3 polynomials. It's a bit surprising, but that it is enough to check this plus and not separately the 2 terms, but it's quite easy to. So why? Yes. Now, what kind of bounds do we know about the subgraph counting polynomial? So first of all, we know that if G is bipartite, then no matter which evaluation you choose, the winner is the following simple graph. You just pick 2 vertices with d multiple edges between them. Surprisingly, you don't really need that these numbers are non-negative, but it's better to have this positive, otherwise it doesn't make much sense. Yes, so actually we also have a conjecture about it, that if we consider d-regular bipartite graphs, but simple, so we don't allow multiple edges, then most probably this quantity is minimized by the complete graph KDD. So this would give a very strong generalization of Bregman theorems and a lot of other theorems. So K33 is just this. But of course, we don't know how to prove it. So let's consider now lower bound for this polynomial. So the first idea is to just keep the empty subgraph and forget everything else. Now, this, of course, if A, the vector A contains only non-negative numbers, this is a good bound, but a completely trivial one, mostly. But you can do the following thing, and this was the idea of Misha and Chernyak, that first you rotate, because this is equality here. So first you rotate, and then you just keep the empty subgraph. Now, unfortunately, there is a problem with this idea. That might be after the rotation you get a lot of negative numbers in the vector, so it's not clear that this is true. Now, the rotation of this vector is this quantity, so what we really ask is the following. Take the maximum of this quantity between 0 and 2 pi, and the problem is that give sufficient condition that FGA is at least CA to the n. Now, actually, this is the beta approximation of this quantity, if you heard about beta approximation. So there are already some known results about this question, which you can apply. So for instance, Damian Strasak and Nishat Vishnoi showed that if this polynomial is rerooted, then this is true. They proved a much more general theorem I just plugged in and checked what happens for this special case. So another theorem is due to Nicola Ruozzi, practically complementary result. So if we have some sort of inequalities, then this is true for a non-negative vector A. So this is some sort of log supermodularity here. Now, we can actually check small cases. So for instance, if we check cycles, this is D equal to 2, then it turns out that this inequality is always true if n is even, so we don't have to do anything. And it is true for an odd n if and only if this discriminant is non-negative. And for D equal to 3, there is a very similar result, but much more complicated, that this inequality is true that if this polynomial is non-negative. Now, this is a sufficient condition, but actually I believe that this is also necessary. So this is the exact condition, most probably. So we can check for our original truncated graph G. So I just repeated this polynomial here. And if we plug in this 1 plus 3 lambda and so on, then it turns out that this is exactly lambda squared. This is non-negative, so we know that this is true, and this is exactly the statement that somehow the large Gauss graph minimizes the this quantity. This. So thank you for your attention.
Just kind of conceptual question. So your proofs, they're essentially algebraic.
Yes.
As opposite to like semi-algebraic.
Yes, yes. So that was somehow really appealing for me when I first saw this method. I wanted to find some sort of identities which explains a lot of previous results.
Usually kind of algebraic methods, they go to limited, yeah. So, but you need some kind of one and at least one inequality, and where it comes from. So you just have identities, and at some point you need to use at least one inequality. So what is that crucial? Maybe simple inequality.
Yeah. Okay. So these inequalities, when you rotate, you have to check what happens with this rotated vector. For instance, if the rotated vector has only non-negative values, then you are done. But maybe it's not necessary that all elements are non-negative. Actually, even in three regular case, it is not important that all of them are non-negative when you rotate. Yes?
So, your focus, of course, is very... Enjoy your talk, great. And your focus on these lower bounds estimates, very nice. And I just want to mention that some of those quantities that came out, like, for example, you had the 00100, which is basically, in the Holland literature, is called the signature.
Yeah.
This 00100 transforming to 1/2 of the 30103 is very much used, and I noticed that you actually called this Z transformation. Is that a coincidence, or you're actually using what in my book's terminology?
Yeah, I used it because you mentioned it yesterday me, and then I looked up and then.
So this is the Kroshchuk thing also comes in. So by the way, there is a sort of a complete classification of what's called a symmetric signatures, which is the 0, x sub 0, x sub 1, x sub 2, according to degree and the value. So there's a lot of connection there.
Yeah. So I definitely realize that there are a huge signature on it.
So are there also results for hypergraphs, say uniform?
I don't have any, but other people might have.
About this beta, so for the permanent, can this method prove that root of 2 to the power n upper bound, which was recently proved by...
I don't know.
But lower bound, is this reproves for the permanent? That beta is the lower bound, or not?
It does not reprove, because actually I cannot even reprove Scriver's theorem at this point. So it gives an identity, it suggests something, but there is no proof yet.
Any more questions or comments? We have plenty of time before the next talk at 11:30, but thank you again. Thank you.